start in the order in which they were presented. So I will start with the paper of PEP that focused on migrant sense of belonging in Spain. I think that what you circulated before, it's a working paper still, but I think that it addresses a really hot topic in migration studies nowadays, which is migrant sense of belonging and identification. And I think that potentially one of the reasons for which this is a hot topic in migration studies is precisely because it's very difficult to conceptualize, it's very difficult to measure, and it's very difficult to explore this this particular dimension that has more effective implications for than others. Now, the comments that I have for you are mainly related to the system, the framework of hypotheses that you are developing in the paper. And in general, I believe that it will be useful if in the next version of the paper you could emphasize a little bit more the literature that you are using in order to back up some of these initial expectations that you are developing. Because I believe that this could provide, let's say, the reader with a better contextualization of these causal mechanisms that you are further exploring it in each one of the hypotheses. And I have some comments for most of the hypotheses. So for instance, for hypothesis one, which I found very interesting, this hypothesis states that you expect no effect of the sense of belonging to the country of origin on the sense of belonging to the host country. But I didn't understand very well in the paper where this expectation came from, especially because in the first part of the article, you seem to mention that there are several studies that actually indicated that a sense of belonging to another country seemed to lead to the weakening of the sense of belonging towards the country of destination. So maybe this is something that you can highlight a little bit better. And actually, I think that it's very relevant, the fact that your findings suggest that indeed there is no effect on the sense of belonging to the home country, on the belonging to the host country. But maybe this is precisely an indicator of the fact that these are multi-layered, overlapping, dual identities, there is no trade-off between them, and potentially they could also be explained by a different configuration of factors rather than looking at them in the same way. Then regarding hypothesis two, in here you expect to find that migrants with higher income and education are more prone to keep a significant sense of belonging to both the home country and the host country at the same time. And I have two potential suggestions in this regard. So first of all, regarding the effect of income and education on sense of belonging towards the home country in particular, I was wondering to what extent this effect might actually be mediated or constrained by the reasons for which migrants have migrated in the first place. And I think that we already have studies from anthropology, sociology as well, highlighting cases of highly skilled migrants who emigrate from their countries of origin precisely because they don't feel comfortable anymore with the system, because the system is corrupt and so on and so forth. So I was wondering that, I was thinking that in this case, the level of education actually works in the different direction than the one that you hypothesized initially. And regarding the positive effect of income and education on sense of belonging to the host country, I was wondering here if this effect hides again another interesting or relevant mechanism, which is that people with higher educational level and higher income are actually more likely to easily find a job in their new countries of residence, to easily interact with the locals, potentially to learn the language more quickly than other migrants, or they are also more likely to easily deal with administrative procedures, with the local administration, and so on and so forth. So these are basically non-obstacles or smaller obstacles for individuals that have higher levels of education slash income when compared to other migrant groups. So maybe, again, this could be something that you could explore in the future. Then you have another hypothesis that is linked to the time of residence and how the time of residence is expected to be negatively associated with identification with a country of origin. And I was wondering if this is actually more likely to happen for individuals that actually cut ties with their countries of origin, but less likely to happen for individuals that, no matter how many years they have spent abroad, they still keep very close contact with their families, with their friends back home, or especially those who have the intention to return at a certain point in their lives. This might play also a role in this. And then, regarding the hypothesis 5 and the self-reported discrimination, I think this is a very interesting element to explore in here. So what you state at the beginning is that self-reported discrimination in the host country negatively affects the identification with the host and positively affects identification with the home country. But I was wondering what happens with individuals that are actually discriminated in the home country prior to departing. And at a certain point in the paper, you mentioned the case of the Roma population, and I was thinking, for instance, the case of the Roma population from Romania, so that are represent a segment of the population that suffers discrimination in the job market, but also in the society in general. So these individuals, are they actually more likely to develop a sense of identification with Romania, for instance, when they move abroad? I believe not. So there might be some nuances depending on the specific groups that we are looking at. And finally, I was wondering about other potential factors that you could also might include in the hypothesis that you will develop for the next draft. For instance, I was thinking, what about language similarity with the host country, or cultural or socioeconomic differences between the home country and the host country, given the fact that you are actually looking at a different nationality? I was thinking that maybe some of these factors could actually explain one of your interesting findings, which is that non-EU migrants tend to become much more identified with Spain when compared to Eastern European migrants. So maybe some of these factors could help us better understand these differences. And then I was thinking, more or less from my own experience, what about individuals who have lived in different countries? Because in this particular case, I believe, or at least it's my case, it's an anecdotic case, but hey, there is some sort of identification fatigue over time. So how does that play a role in the sense of attachment that you manage to develop over time towards the country of residence? Then another line for you to explore in the future, potential differences between generations of migrants, first generation versus second generation, also being part of different associations of immigrants / emigrants. There are different policies that even the countries of origin implement in order to maintain their contacts with the diaspora and make the diaspora feel or maintain their sense of belonging towards the countries of origin. So maybe that could be also something that you could explore in the future. And just regarding the analysis, a very brief comment about potential collinearity between different independent variables that you have in there, such as age or having children, or age and years of residence in the host country, or household income and being affected by the economic crisis. This thing of being affected by the economic crisis, in my view, unless you develop a specific hypothesis about that, you can actually keep it out, because in any case you are measuring the household income. But very, very interesting paper, and I think that you have lots of potential to further explore other dimensions related to this. Then I have, I believe, less comments for Hector Grat over there. So this is the second paper. In here I was a little bit puzzled because I didn't know exactly what to say, because the paper that you circulated, I understand it has been already published, but the presentation also added new elements to that paper, although it's my understanding that more or less you follow the same theoretical, conceptual, analytical rationale that you developed in the paper. So I have in your case, rather than comments on how to improve, I have suggestions for the future in case you might want to continue exploring this particular line. But I will start from the paper that you circulated, because I found that one very interesting thing that you had in there is the fact that the pattern of tolerance towards migrants in general that Spaniards tend to show based on the data that we have from the national survey, doesn't seem to match at all the perceptions and the experiences of migrants themselves. So you say at the beginning of the chapter that the survey of the Ecuadorian population in Spain actually highlighted that Ecuadorians still perceive strong discrimination, strong prejudice, and almost half of them, actually, I think it is, actually reported that they have been discriminated either in the labor market or on the street. So I think that one very interesting element that you can further explore is to what explains this mismatch between the general openness of Spaniards towards migrants in general, as reported by the National Service, surveys and the general perception of discrimination that is reported by migrants themselves, or in your case, the case of Ecuadorians. And I was wondering, in this regard, to what extent these attitudes that are generally favorable toward migrants in general might vary substantially when you are looking at specific nationalities. And I think that this is something that you can, again, explore in the future. On the one side, to try to trace in a more systematic way this gap between the expectations of assimilation that Spaniards have and the expectations of, or the perceptions of migrants regarding how these expectations actually develop over time. And secondly, to see how these expectations of assimilation actually vary depending on different nationalities, if whether there are any important differences, for instance, between the Romanians, the Moroccans, the Latin Americans. These are sizable communities in Spain, but then again, they count with different linguistic characteristics. They count with a different cultural closeness, if I'm allowed to say so, compared to the Spaniards. They, in some cases, talk about post-colonial ties, in others we are not. So these, I think, are very interesting factors for you to explore in the future. And then something that you mentioned, that Spain combines a clear openness towards immigration and ethnocultural diversity with strong assimilation expectations. So the first thing that came to my mind, probably because now I'm based in Belgium and these things come to my mind very easily, is the question, assimilation into what? So we are talking about Spain here, a country where, as you mentioned in the chapter as well, there is substantial regional variation, there is a linguistic diversity, a cultural diversity, and the lines between the we and us and other are kind of blurred depending on the context that you are looking at. So I was thinking, even conceptually speaking, are migrants, but also apply to your case, are migrants actually expected to assimilate into the local context, meaning the municipality in which they reside, in the comunidad autónoma, or in the country as a whole? And I believe that here there is another research line that you can potentially explore in the future, which is trying to look at regional variations. In this regard, to see if comunidades autónomas that have different linguistic traditions, but also different experiences with immigration, not only in terms of the numbers of migrants that they have received, but also the diversity of these migrant groups, can develop different patterns from the ones that you showed us today. And then I think it would also be super interesting to try to explore, if the data allows it, how these expectations of assimilation or the cultural distance between Spaniards and migrants evolve over time. For instance, depending on how much interpersonal contact migrants, Spaniards develop with migrants. Because in the paper you are developing an argument regarding post-colonial ties, which I found very, very interesting, but I believe that this type of longitudinal analysis would probably allow us to see if colonialism is actually the main factor that shapes Spaniards' attitudes towards Ecuadorians, in this case, regardless of the type of contacts or the number of contacts that they have with citizens of Ecuador, or on the contrary, if this coloniality shapes the attitudes of the autochthonous population only at the beginning, in time one of their contact with Ecuadorian, but it actually fades away over time, the more you get engaged, the more you actually learn about the other group and so on and so forth. And then I have some questions. I have one remark about the comparison between in-group contacts, because in here one of the important findings that you highlighted in the chapter, but it didn't come out in the presentation, is the fact that Ecuadorians have far more friends and frequency of contact with Spaniards than Spanish war participants have with Ecuadorian migrants. I think this is just a matter of numbers, that the pool of Ecuadorians that Spaniards can actually get in contact with is far more limited than the pool of Spaniards that Ecuadorians can get in contact with. And then one final remark is about the contact hypothesis. So this contact hypothesis, if I understood it correctly, stipulates that more intercultural contact will predict higher support for multicultural acculturation and higher intercultural adaptation. So if I understand that correctly, suggesting here is that the more you have contact with the other group, more tolerant you will actually become over time. I think this is super interesting, but I was wondering to what extent it can actually be the other way around, that people that have a higher level of tolerance are more likely, more inclined to actually get in contact and get to know better the other group. So I think it can play both ways. And then some remarks for the future, should you want to continue with this super interesting line of research. I was thinking about maybe at some point you can also incorporate the gender dimension to see to what extent the attitudes towards or contact with Ecuadorians in your case might be any different depending on male or female migrants. Also, the role of education, this is something that came up also from the presentation of PEP. I think it's very interesting in shaping contacts, in shaping attitudes. And then maybe another thing that you could also explore is this generational gap, meaning acculturation between first and second generation migrants to do that in a more systematic way. And then I think there is plenty of research in psychology that is trying to see to what extent people's expectations or relations with the other groups are actually shaped by their own perceptions of trust, what trust is and who you can actually trust. So again, this might be something that could be interesting for you to analyze in the future. And Hector, I don't have actually comments for you because... Yeah, well, I received the PowerPoint presentation. Sorry. I realize now that I misunderstood it. So I believe that, okay, first of all, I think that this is a really, really interesting topic. Even though I understand that you have not started yet with the paper, I believe that this has lots of potential. And even though what you said at the beginning, that this is focused on a rather niche topic, unlike the other two papers that discuss more broad, dimensions regarding immigrant integration, I still believe that it has lots of potential and that it can have serious implications as well for policy design, should policymakers actually care about the results of our study. But I think that this is a really, really interesting topic. And I really like the innovation that you bring compared to the, I'm not familiar with the literature that you are using, but from what I understood in your presentation, the main contribution that you are trying to bring is this way in which you look at how the impact of concentration on levels of student performance differ between the best performing ones and the less performing ones. And what I believe is that at the beginning, while looking at your PowerPoint presentation, I didn't understand that very well, especially because it seems that the literature before has not discussed about this, so this is your innovation in this regard. But because it's an innovation, I also believe that you should make the causal mechanism a little bit more explicit in the paper to try to specify from the very beginning, so okay, these are my expectations on how concentration of migrants in school affects the best performing one and the worst performing ones. Because in the case of the best performing ones, I understood more or less how is the situation, but in the case of the worst performing ones, I didn't understand very well what was the initial expectation, that they will perform worse than the worst. And then I think my general comment for your presentation was how controversial this type of research can actually become, because at the end of the day, it's a very hot issue with serious political consequences, especially. So the first part of your hypothesis states that migrant concentration is likely to lead to an overrepresentation of low-performing students, thus making teachers adapt or lower their level of exigency. And because I'm not familiar with the literature, at the beginning when I read that, I was like, oops, certain policymakers, certain political parties are likely to actually take that out of context and well, propose different types of policy measures that do not reflect the reality that well. So I was wondering, but you explained it quite well in the presentation, of where does this come from? What is the causal mechanism at the end of the day? So you mentioned yourself, we have mixed empirical evidence in this regard, and it is still not clear to me. Of course, you presented on the Spanish case, but it's still not clear to me if this is related to poverty in the neighborhood, if it's poverty or if it's actually lack of resources that schools in this neighborhood have, if it's actually a lower quality of teaching among the professors, among the teaching staff, and so on and so forth. So it's a little bit of still a puzzle in my mind of what would be the causal mechanism behind that. But what it is clear, at least from the presentation as I understood it, is that it's not about immigration concentration, and this is the good news that we can show at least for the Spanish case. Then regarding the survey, so if I understood correctly, this is something that you conducted in 2011, so
the ministry, so
I was wondering if whether there are any plans to extend this, because it would be really interesting. You said it yourself that that a large majority of the studies developed in this area tend to look at longitudinal data, and especially so the economy. So I was wondering if there is the possibility to do that in your case. And then I was wondering regarding this language effect, it wasn't that clear to me, because there are studies that look at educational attainment and the effect of migration on educational attainment, but some of them actually focus on reading courses, for instance, on evaluating performance in reading courses rather than in mathematics, as you're doing here. And I was thinking, yeah, we were discussing yesterday as well with other colleagues that, okay, mathematics might be a course in which of course you need a basic language skills, but at the end of the day it's not the same as a reading course in terms of students. And then I was thinking that we are talking about migrant students, but then we all know that this is not a homogeneous group at all. So I was wondering if whether you have any expectations regarding individuals that actually come, migrant children that actually come from better educational systems than the one of Spain, those that actually speak more languages, let alone the native language, than Spanish students, those that are born and raised here, so they have actually in Spain, so they have actually started the education in the Spanish system, versus those that came from other countries and continue their education in Spain. Because, okay, in a scenario in which we have migrant students that migrated, I don't know at whichever age, but after having a prior contact with the educational system in their countries of origin, one might expect that any difference that we might find are due to the differences in the educational system between the home and the host. But in the case of students that actually come from, that have had the first contact with the Spanish system only, it was not very clear to me why would we expect lower performance. Is it because, again, of the background of the parents, or is it something else? Or, yeah, so maybe you can say a few words about that. Thanks again to all the paper.